I'm part of the Cloud Foundry product group at Pivotal. Runs our customer engagement, which essentially means I get the fun job of running around, talking to customers, bringing requirements, and shaping the product. If you were at Platform on Sunday and Monday, you'd seen a lot of these big names talking about Cloud Foundry and what they're doing with it. So folks like Swisscom, Intel, Warner Music, GE, and a lot of other guys that we're working with. So it's a pretty exciting time for us. My background, I joined Pivotal from VMware, where I essentially launched Cloud Foundry around 2 years ago with the team, basically from the first t-shirt, if you like. So we should get one of those kind of old ones. And my background, I'm an engineer. In my background, did a lot of J2E implementation, had my share of 30,000 lines of Apache config files. Then I spent a bunch of years at Yahoo doing Hadoop implementations. So to me, a lot of what Pivotal is doing with Cloud Foundry and big data is so abstraction of PaaS with the combination of big data is quite exciting. So what we'll do today in the next 90 minutes or so, we'll start with an introduction to Cloud Foundry, talk a little bit about the Pivotal platform, jump into a demo, which is the best way to see Cloud Foundry, and then talk about the Cloud Foundry architecture in specific, and we'll spend time explaining exactly what happens when you push an application to Cloud Foundry. So the previous session, if for those who were here, talked a lot about how you deploy Cloud Foundry itself on different infrastructures. With Bosch, we are going to focus on what happens when Cloud Foundry runs and you as a developer deploys application to it and what happens, what are the components. Then we're going to switch over to our friends from AppDirect and SendGrid, who will kind of show you in live what it means to have Cloud Foundry extendable. So the extensibility of Cloud Foundry is key and our ecosystem is massive and we love you guys here. So they'll show you what it means when we're saying that Cloud Foundry is extensible. So in a nutshell, we define ourselves, so Cloud Foundry is essentially a PaaS. It's an open PaaS. And open is much more than open source. So we'll talk about a lot about that. Our mission in life is deploy and scale application in seconds, essentially abstracts the VMs and middleware and infrastructures from developers and operators and allowing them to get apps to market, get app deployed much quicker. And it's all around speed. Speed of agility for deploying apps, speed of scaling apps, speed of binding services to an app. The fundamental thing to understand from a Cloud Foundry architecture point of view is that the application is the unit of deployment, not the VMs, not the middleware. Essentially, the way Cloud Foundry works is you are pushing an application, you're pushing your application code to the PaaS system, and that PaaS system essentially take that application bits, take your source code, add the runtime, the necessary runtime to it. In the case of, let's say, Java, then we are adding the Apache, the JDK, SQL connectors if you need to access a database, your web server. And then we are executing everything in a container within a VM. So you are not directly accessing a virtual machine. You are not directly starting an app server. You are not directly starting a web server. What you're doing is you're pushing an application code and you're binding to services. And that's a key difference than you know, you have an Apache running or a Tomcat running and you're pushing your code into it and the container, sorry, and the app server and the VM that it's running on are the center of the universe. In the case of Cloud Foundry, the application is the center of the universe. That's the unit that you deploy. That's the unit that you scale. That's the unit that you control. And the best way to see that is in a demo that we'll get to in a few minutes. This chart is actually taken from one of our existing customers that we're not talking at Platform over the weekend. This is their deployment chart. This is taking an app from code complete, essentially, to staging. It's not even to production. Every manual step here, this is a very big retail enterprise, by the way. One of their, every colored box here is a manual step. It's not your eyes, it's blurred for a reason, because it's the actual deployment chart and it's confidential. But the point I'm making is that it takes them months, literally between 5 and 7 months, depend on the app, to get something from code complete to a staging deployment, right? That's crazy, and you can see why. Because every step of the chart, they need to submit a ticket, wait for someone to open something, to configure a DNS, to certify some MySQL version, to say this thing is okay, this thing is not okay, and then they have to redo it all over again when they're moving from dev to QA, and all over again when they're moving from QA to staging, and on and on and on. If there's one thing I want you to take away from this talk, is that our mission in life with Cloud Foundry, as a community, and it's not about one vendor versus the other, as a community, our job is to simplify that nightmare into a few basic steps. And those steps essentially have two actors in them. The operator, and again, if you were in the last talk, you heard a lot about the operator and what does it mean to provision Cloud Foundry and how you provision it, how you're adding capacity, how you're upgrading with zero downtime. I'm not going to focus as much on that because we only have an hour and I want to leave time to my colleagues here. So I'm mainly going to focus on the blue part, on what does it mean to target a cloud, push an application, bind a service, and scale the application. So going through that nightmare of deployment into a very few simple verbs. The one thing I would say about operations is that Cloud Foundry really decouples between the ops and the deployment phase. So essentially, if you're a user, a QA person, a developer, an operator deploying apps, from your perspective, the Cloud Foundry instance has infinite capacity, right? And so when you want to scale that cloud, the operators can do that offline, essentially, with zero downtime, without any effect to your application. And as we've been running Cloud Foundry in production for more than 2 years on our hosted service back at Pivotal, and we've been eating our own dog food of multi-cloud. We started on a vSphere infrastructure. We moved to AWS. And we're also eating our own dog food in terms of scaling. We started from... I think in the first day we had like a backlog of 30,000 users, and now we are in the hundreds of thousands. So we keep adding capacity to this cloud. We keep adding functionality to this cloud. We support languages like Node.js that has, you know, new version every second Tuesday. So we need to keep updating this cloud, and we're doing it using the mechanisms of Bosch that we're now making available for you as a commercial product. So Bosch is also let's move on, sorry. So Cloud Foundry essentially has three, I would say, integration points, or we describe this as a triangle, clouds, runtimes, and app services. And when we'll talk about the architecture, we'll go deeper into the custom runtimes and custom services. We will not go deep into the custom clouds. Again, those who were in the previous talk seen the Bosch CPI. If you want to learn more about this, please come to me after the talk and we can drill down a little bit. So I'm going to focus on the runtimes and app services. The idea is that you can provide, a PaaS is great for productivity. It's an awesome agility tool, but we also live in the real world. So we did not take the approach of App Engine, for example, where it's essentially my way or the highway, or an approach where you are kind of stuck into one cloud. When you choose your PaaS, you choose your cloud. We believe that there is, for anyone to adopt a PaaS in real-life enterprise environments, three things needs to be available. You can have a choice of infrastructures, so you can run it on a public environment or on a private environment. Cloud Foundry has now production customers for both AWS as a public option, OpenStack as a private option or VMware as a private option, vSphere. And it's literally, you just target between those clouds and you don't need to change your code anywhere, right? So I was personally involved in a big project back in my Yahoo days of moving an app that was unfortunately successful on AWS back in-house because we had to start dealing with production data and there was no way we could deal with that staying on Amazon. And pretty much after a few months of efforts, essentially we gave up, right? It was just too much work to move it back in-house because the architecture was so different. The reason is because the abstraction is not in the right place. With Cloud Foundry, since the application is the unit of deployment, that makes the abstraction level, the abstraction line, and the separation of concern between the app architecture and the infrastructure much easier. So you can really move an app from vSphere to OpenStack to Amazon, back in-house, and cloud essentially does not become a consideration yet, a consideration anymore. Or the way I like to say it is when you choose your paths, you're not forced to choose your cloud. The other two aspects that we're going to focus when we look at the detail architecture, we support runtimes and frameworks out of the box. Obviously, Spring for us is, Spring is part of Pivotal, in case you didn't know. This is a first-class citizen for us, and we're investing a lot in having the best experience for Spring developers. Essentially, as you will see in the demo, you don't need to learn anything new as a Spring developer when you're deploying into Cloud Foundry. And we support other frameworks out of the box, like Ruby and Node. But most importantly, we realize that when you're deploying Cloud Foundry on your environment, on-premise, you would need to do some changes to those runtimes. All the way from, starting from I just want to use a different version of Java to I want to use a different app server than Tomcat and Apache. I want to use JBoss, for example, to I want to use a language that you guys don't support. So I have Python developers and I want to use them with the PaaS and I still want them to have the same level of productivity. So for that, we adopted a model called BuildPacks, which was developed by Heroku. And we extended it to a mode to a point where you can literally bring your own runtime into Cloud Foundry, all the way from customizing our defaults to introducing a new frameworks and new runtimes, and your developer experience will remain the same. And we'll talk a little bit about that and how we do it. Services, similar approach. We come with certain services out of the box. But we believe that in order to run a successful PaaS on your environment, you would want to plug in into your own services. So we'll talk a lot about our marketplace, and we'll see SendGrid and AppDirect as a great example of how we're doing public marketplace on Cloud Foundry. And we'll also describe how you can add your own services or user-defined services to Cloud Foundry. From a building block point of view, one thing to understand is that Cloud Foundry essentially takes the model of an app running on an infrastructure, separate silos, with a specific VM, app server, JVMs, and configurations, into a model where it's running within a container, in a container within a VM. So we adopted, if you're familiar with the Linux containers and C groups, so we kind of combine those two into something we call Warden. So essentially a Warden, if you will, the easiest way to explain it, it's a VM inside a VM. So it's a container that has its own dedicated OS, basically a stem cell running inside a VM, and you can have many containers per VM, or you can have one container per VM. It's completely up to you. Within that container, essentially what we do is we install instantly all of the runtime components of the app, including the source code. So in the case of the Spring app we'll deploy, you will see that we are taking this droplet, which is a bag of bits that has your source code, your raw file, your JDK, JVM, Tomcat, Apache, and any kind of connectors that you need. We take this bag of bits and we essentially install them on the fly from fresh in a container inside a VM very, very quickly. It takes us a fraction of a second. I believe the number is 2 milliseconds to actually start a container within a virtual machine. And then we just install very quickly all of the necessary components in it and run your app and connect your app. And we'll look in detail on the flow of what happens when you push the application. But from a conceptual point of view, you can think of the traditional stack kind of collapsing into everything is executing within a VM. And there is a layer of manifest and automation that we'll take a look at that runs on top of it. What does that give you? First of all, the ability to have all of this as infrastructure agnostic, so you're not building silos per infrastructure. Second, in terms of all this nightmare of schema changes, update configurations, updates in place, essentially our approach is you always start from a fresh container. So if you have an update to your app and you have a new instance, we very quickly start this on a fresh container, and then you can just route the URL. We have an ability to map URLs between those two instances, and that's how you upgrade your app. So you don't need to go to all of those tools that forces you to update in place something that's run in a Tomcat, and that Tomcat never goes away. In our world, the VM or the container within a VM is something you always start fresh. So if something wrong with that container, boom, we shoot it in the head, we start something new. And we'll talk about states and stuff later. So that's from a conceptual point of view. Okay. This is probably the most common use case that I see when I go and talk to our customers for our commercial product and as well for folks that have adopted our open source, our Cloud Foundry open source. And it's around the combination between agile methodologies and agile platforms. So when folks are adopting agile development and moving away from waterfall, it's all great, but it has to be accompanied by a platform that can support that. So a very common problem we see customers complain about is we adopted an agile platform, an agile methodology, that's great, but we essentially run, and we wait because we wait for someone to provision the next environment. It takes them 3 weeks until we can get a VM, and all of our agility is kind of gone away. The way it works with Cloud Foundry is essentially on the same platform, you are carving out those environments, we call them spaces, we will talk about this in the demo, and you just move between those spaces, so you don't have to wait for anyone to provision a new environment. And you can have you can carve out different, you can completely control the isolation between those environments. You can go all the way from saying, for production, I want to have a completely separate Cloud Foundry instance running on separate hardware and separate VMs, and it's all in its network, and it's completely separate. For QA and dev and staging, I want to have another instance, and I can separate between the environments using the concept of spaces and DEA pools. We'll talk a little bit about that. And essentially, what's important is when I'm deploying my application, it's just targeting a different cloud. So essentially, I'm just choosing my target, and that target can be a space within my development environment, or it can be a different Cloud Foundry instance. And that's kind of the scenario we'll follow in the demo as well. And we'll show how we're doing it. I'll spend 2 minutes talking about the Pivotal platform. I really don't want to make any vendor pitches here, but Pivotal sells a commercial product called Pivotal CF based on Cloud Foundry. Essentially, that product, it combines the Cloud Foundry PaaS as the runtime, the Cloud Foundry infrastructure for deploying things, essentially Bosch, so being able to deploy on any cloud, with data assets like Pivotal HD, the Hadoop distribution, analytics, RabbitMQ. So you're getting all of that under one platform. And what's another thing that is unique, I think, about the way we work is when I said open is more than open source, we strongly believe in an open door policy. And for those of you who attended Platform, there were like 500 people in a room, came on a Sunday to just hear how the community grows. This was really, the energy in the room was like phenomenal. I've never seen something like that. And there is a reason for that, because all the way from companies like Warner Music and Intel and GE to individual developers, they're all kind of they would want to contribute to this open paths and open doors. So we got IBM, for example, came to the Pivotal Labs in San Francisco and paired programmed with us and built the product with us and launched a build pack for their Liberty solution. Warner Music came and paired with us and kind of came with a contributor solution around logging that the community can benefit from, and so on and so on. So we believe that open source is the way to deliver software in the cloud era, but it also needs to be an open policy of, you know, getting the engineering from different vendors talking to each other. And I think maybe you'll hear more from AppDirect and SendGrid here about like what it is to, what does open policy really means. And, you know, these guys are probably can talk to that better than me. In terms of how Pivotal CF looks like as a product, so it's a little hard to see, but you can have, when you're installing this thing, you can choose your infrastructure. For example, our first release will be is on vSphere, so you choose a vSphere environment, then you have the Cloud Foundry runtime itself, and different services like MySQL, Pivotal HD, Analytics, RabbitMQ, and so on. It's all based on the open source code base. So essentially you can do, think of this as a nice installer and a nice UI and administrator capabilities on top of the open source components. So let's, I think we spoke enough, so let's jump into a demo. So what I'm going to show you is, this is the Cloud Foundry portal, right? Right now I'm showing you the user console. It runs in our hosted service on AWS. Everything that I'm showing you is going to work exactly the same when that instance is running on-prem. So instead of console.run.pivotal.io, which is the URL for our hosted service, it will be console.mycompany.com. So it's exactly the same. The console itself is nothing more than a Cloud Foundry app. So once you are deploying Cloud Foundry on-prem, we are provisioning or deploying this as yet another app on your cloud. Now what I've done here is I defined an org, which is called Cloud Foundry Demo. Think of an org as like a big line of business within your company or a big project, anything that has multiple apps involved and different stages in the life cycle. And within that org, we have three spaces: dev, testing, staging. A space is a logical entity that defines a group of users that pushing applications that can see the same applications and the same services. A space can be anything you want. This is just an example. It's just a name. A space can be another logical entity within your organization. In this case, it can be multiple development teams, and you can have as many spaces as you like. In this specific demo, I defined three spaces, one for our dev team, one for our testing team, and one for our staging team. And the scenario is that in a production environment, you will have a separate Cloud Foundry instance that will have a separate portal. And each space has its own set of users, and we'll show how we control it. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to take this nice little Spring app, which is an online bookstore, and directly from STS, we're going to deploy it into Cloud Foundry, first into the development space, and then we'll push it into the QA space. When we'll deploy it into the development space, we'll create our own services. When we'll deploy it into the QA space, we're actually going to use a pre-provisioned set of services that were provided to us by our company DBA in that example. Now, this is a Spring MVC example app. I'm not going to change a single line of code here or a single configuration. It's just drag and drop into Cloud Foundry. And if we have time, we'll show how we, you know, move environment variables. If not, you can come to me after the show and I can just walk you through the code. But the bottom line is, as a Spring developer, I literally don't have to learn anything new. I'm not changing my code one bit. So the first stage is we're actually going to create a connector into Cloud Foundry. So new server here, we're going to Pivotal. We'll call it CF dev because we're connecting into our dev environment. And then we're going to provide an email. That's my account on our hosted service. And a password, if I hope I remember that correctly. We're doing validate account. What happens now is that the STS plugin essentially reads, the Eclipse plugin reads the names of the spaces and the orgs in my account. And now if I'll do next, you see I get that list, Cloud Foundry demo, that's my org, and I'm selecting development. By the way, Cloud Foundry has two clients, the CLI and STS. The exact same thing I can do from a command line. But since we are at Spring 1, I thought it's way better to show STS and not command line. So now I have this dev environment, this dev connector set up, and all I'm doing right now is just drag and drop into my dev environment. Okay? And now I'm going to give the app a name. Oh, that's interesting. Small glitch here. Oh, there we go. So I give it a name. Let's call it book dev. And it's going to run on this cfapps.io host, which is our default domain name for apps deployed on our hosted service. Obviously, when I'll show you how you do it in a minute, but in your enterprise, you can, or your company, you can decide to choose whatever URL you want, whatever domain you want. So this one is going to be hosted on bookdev.cfapps.io. I can select the amount of memory. Let's increase this a little bit. Now, this is not the VM memory. This is the memory of the container that's going to run within a VM. Okay? So when we'll talk about the deployment flow, remember that, and I'll show you how we allocate the container. But we are not starting a virtual machine or an AMI in that case. We are not configuring a load balance or a web server. None of that is happening by me as I'm doing deployment. Now, a bookstore without a place to store book doesn't mean a lot. So let's create two services. So that specific app uses a database and a NoSQL store. So we'll define both. So in this case, I'm going to create my DevDB, and I can choose from a list. Now, because this is our hosted service, I have a list of services here that are available to us through the marketplace and thanks to AppDirect, Service Broker, which you'll hear a lot in a minute, we can see all these services. In your private environment, you'll expose services that comes out of the box with Cloud Foundry, for example, MySQL and RabbitMQ, and also services that you defined user, the user-defined capability. So in this case, I'm going to select two services from our marketplace, a database based on ClearDB, and a NoSQL store based on Redis. And apologies, for, I didn't have a SandGrid demo, but that's all right. So let's say, dev, let's send some emails. But I don't have this demo right now, so I'm just going to select Redis. And now the app is being deployed. Now what happens in the background, let's go back to our URL here, and let's refresh the development. And as you can see, already I have one service started, which is the dev NoSQL. I can manage it and I can control it from here. And if I'll click another refresh, we'll see that we have another service created based on ClearDB, and here is my app starting to being staged. And we'll talk about what happens in the staging phase in 1 second. While we're waiting for that to be staged, let's go over some other nice features of the portal. So users, you can see I have different users per space, right? So in development I have 4 users, and in QA I have 2 users. I can define that here via the users tab, and I can define roles to each user. Now in our commercial product, it comes with a LDAP plugin. So essentially you can plug in into your Active Directory and you don't have to define all of these users and a bunch of other nice enterprise related features. And you can define roles for who can push an app to QA, who can be a QA, who can define which users are part of the QA space and so on. And again, these spaces are just names. So you can have total flexibility of structuring your groups however you see fit. In the org settings themselves, if you remember, we talked about the domain. So I have ability here to add a domain. So instead of cfapps.io, I can say something like, oops, like mycompany.com, and as long as I have the CNAME and the DNS entry configured correctly, that's it. I can deploy app to mycompany.com. And marketplace. So this is something that looks like this for our hosted service. In your private environment, you will have different logos or different names. And this is all exposed via the AppDirect service broker. And you will hear more about this in a minute. So let's go to our app spaces and see what's the status of our book dev. So here we are. And we have the app deployed. And let's see what happens in the console. So maybe we can show that. So the console gives you, you can see a little bit of what's going on. Just give me 1 minute. Scrolling up here. Oh, these are the most tricky part of the demo. Okay. Hopefully you can see that. Okay. I know it's a little hard to see, but let's go over what happened. So when we drag and drop the app, we basically started with a WAR file. That WAR file is this 19 megs here. It's all my source code compiled. The way we do the build pack or the compilation for Java is essentially we're using a WAR file, a pre-compiled code. When we are deploying Ruby applications, for example, we're actually compiling the code as part of the deployment. And this is based on the way Java folks, they expect to, they're used to work, I believe you guys, everyone is used to work with a WAR file, so it's pre-compiled. So we're starting with this 19 meg. And then we are following a set of instructions. Those instructions are defined in our build pack. A build pack is nothing more than a set of, you can think of it as the most simplistic way is to think about it, is a Unix script, right? That has a set of instructions of how to assemble the necessary runtime components on top of my source code in order for this to be executed in the container. So in the case of our app, this is the Java build pack. So we're using an OpenJDK. We're using a JRE, autoconfig because we have MySQL dependencies. We are just in the process, I believe it was announced during this show, the new Java build pack that we have as part of Cloud Foundry. We now can auto-detect which kind of services you're using and not downloading all of the configurations, so that's pretty cool. Downloading Tomcat, and essentially taking all of that bits, and from this 19 megs, we are now in the 56 meg, which is all the things that are needed in order to actually run this app. Because my source code alone is not going to help me too much. Now, the beauty of all of this is everything is configured and in a very easy way. So if I want to customize this build pack in my own environment, I can say, hey, don't go and download OpenJDK. Download whatever JDK I'm certified. Download whatever JVM version I'm certified on, whatever Tomcat version, or a different app server. So you have total flexibility of customizing this. But the nice thing is the developers themselves don't really care about this. You as an operator can provide them with a set of build packs, either one build pack for all of your Java applications or even a few different stacks of build packs. One of the customers we're engaging with right now, a big financial services bank, they have 500 plus permutations for their apps. Just different stacks running all over because every developer wants a different version of MySQL for whatever reason. There is no real reason for that. They did an analysis and they came for the conclusion they can deal with only 4 stacks out of these 500. So what they need to do is just tell their developers, hey, you're going to deploy with one of these 4 stacks. And they even know for which app they need which stack because it's all coming to what version of JDK was certified for that specific area of the bank. Now with build packs, it's so simple. They can just write extend our Java default build packs to 4 different ones and associate that even with like a specific space. So all of the developers that are members, I'm just making this up, members of the foreign trading development group will use this build pack. So all the developers member of another division of the bank will use that bill pack or whatever. But this is an example of how you can basically reach some sort of a golden golden balance between productivity and productivity, extensibility, and customization. Now, once that 56 megs are done, they are shipped for the container for execution, and we'll talk exactly about how that happened in a second. So let's get back to our app here. And it should be deployed or not. Well, if it all goes according to plan, then something is wrong with the demo, right? Where is my, okay. I don't know why it's not deployed, but we can restart this. But you guys, you'll believe me that this is deployed. Probably something is wrong here. But so let's now run this on another space. So let's create another server, and I'll show you how simple it is to basically direct into another. To our QA environment. So let's call it QA dev, right? Sorry, QA space, QA cloud, QA, CFQA. So we targeted the dev space, now let's target the QA space. Again, we're putting our credentials in here. The next version of the plugin will have the ability to switch between spaces within this. You won't have to enter your credentials twice. So even that step will be saved from you. And now, if you remember, I chose the development space, and I'm going to choose the QA testing space. And now I can take the same app, and I'll deploy it into the CFQA. Now, the difference is, this time, when I'll go to services, I'll already see a list of services that are pre-populated to me, because if I go here to test to QA, you see that I have these apps already deployed. These services already deployed. Now, the scenario is these services, unlike the one we did before when we actually created the dev services, these services were created for me by the company's DBA as a user-defined services. So they can be a connection to my production Oracle, or a connection to my SQL server, or whatever services the DBA essentially wants me to use in production or close to production environments. And when I go here, let's say we'll call it this time Book QA, and it's hosted on bookqacfapps.io. And if I'll go next here, you see I already have those two services available for me. Now, I didn't see them last time because I was targeting the dev space. Now I'm targeting the QA space, so I see these services and I can choose them. And obviously I have permission in this case to target both the QA, the dev, and the QA space. Probably there will be different users that have access to those different spaces, and so on. So we'll see if that thing starts, and maybe we can troubleshoot this a little later. Let's switch back to the slides, because the one I want to show you basically the application flow. So this is how Cloud Foundry PaaS look like. So we're not going to touch about Bosch. Think of this as a black box that allows you to deploy on any type of infrastructure, right? These are the components that are essentially part of Cloud Foundry runtime itself. So there is a router. And a cloud controller. We'll talk in detail about what this guy's doing while I was deploying the app. Then we have the logging servers. How are we doing on time? We have 10 more minutes, pretty much. So these guys are essentially the UAA, the user authentication and authorization service, is the guy that is responsible for, you know, when I was targeting different spaces and I had different accounts for each space and all these authentication mechanisms and the LDAP integration, that's all done here. A health manager One cool demo that we're doing is we're starting a bunch of instances and then we're killing some of those instances. And the health manager automatically restart the instances. So if I said I need 4 instances of my app or 10 instances of my app and 2 of them suddenly dies, then there is an automatic start of another 2 instances to make sure that the SLA is maintained. So these kind of things the health manager does. DEA pools. So the space that I've shown you, you have ability to associate a space with a pool of DEAs. Now, why would you want to do it? For let's say, for example, you want to make sure all of your apps are you know, all of the apps in this specific space are executed in that vCenter security zone for whatever reason. Now, since we are abstracting the infrastructure itself, essentially what we're saying is you can associate a space with a certain DEA pool, and how you associate that DEA pool, or what is the manifestation of that DEA pools on your specific infrastructure, is something that the administrators or the operators of deploying Cloud Foundry on that specific infrastructure will decide. In other words, there is a separation of concern between how you deploy CF on a specific infrastructure and how you can carve out those isolations. And again, the best way to, a best use case for that is a dev space will be associated with one DEA pool, and a QA space will be associated with another DEA pool, or an app that needs to have some sort of a HA capabilities will have some of these some of its instances running on one DEA pool and some of its instances running on another DEA pool to make sure that if one zone fails, essentially, you still have HA. Service broker, we'll talk a lot about this in the second part of the presentation. User-defined services. So essentially, as we said, you can hook up to a service that you run, like an Oracle service or a business logic service. So customers that we're engaging with are basically using this concept to run, you know, a black box of a legacy app that they don't want to touch and they are not going to port into a PaaS, but they still need it they still need the functionality. So essentially, they are treating it as a service that you just connect to using the user-defined services. Essentially, the way it works is dead simple. It's think about it as a JDBC connector that you're doing create service, providing us with the URL to hook to that service, and we take it from there. We do not. The difference between that and the service nodes and the service broker is for user-defined services, we're not managing the lifecycle of the service. We're not starting it, we're not stopping it, we're not monitoring it, anything. We're just connecting to it based on the information that you provided. The nice thing about this is from a developer point of view or from a user point of view, there is no difference. The developers that just deployed this online bookstore didn't care from the list if those are user-defined or core services or marketplace services or whatever. Now, by the way, everything we work on in terms of roadmap questions, and it's all publicly available. As I said, open is more than open source. Everything that we work on is visible in this cftracker.cfapps.io, so you can go there and see all the stories and what we are working on all the time. Yep.
So for each of these components, right, after you've done the Bosch deployment and everything, each one of those things in a box is going to be a virtual machine, or they are all?
No, each one of those are a container. Now you can have more than, you can have several health managers and several cloud controllers, and when you are installing Cloud Foundry, you can say how many instances of each one of those core components do I want.
And then is there like a sort of set number of virtual machines?
There is a minimal number of virtual machines for the core components, and then the number of DEAs is all depend on how much pool of capacity do you want, how many applications do you want to run. Right, so you can have the minimum. You can have one DEA, and that will allow you to run certain amount of containers up to the limit of that VM. But you would probably want a few dozens virtual machines to serve as DEA, so you can run many applications. Right.
So I mean, for the core, that would be saving you a few virtual machines.
Yeah, there is actually, I don't want to go into that because that was kind of the previous talk. So like exactly how many VMs do you need to install Cloud Foundry? We can talk about this offline. I'll send you a link that shows you exactly what's the minimal requirement. But what I'd like to focus this talk is less on the operation side, but more on what happens when Cloud Foundry is up and running and you're deploying applications. Okay, make sense? And so come back to me. So let's see what actually happens when I'm deploying an app, right? So when I did the drag and drop or the equivalent from a CLI, which is called CF push, I basically interacted with the Cloud Foundry API. What STS does, the CF plugin, is essentially providing a set of REST calls back to the cloud controller. And that REST call to the cloud controller essentially said, look, Mr. Cloud Controller, now I'm a user, I'm part of this space, and I want to deploy this app. And that's the target phase, right? So when I created that target into a specific space within a specific cloud, I essentially targeted the cloud controller. Then the cloud controller talks to the DEA. The DEA is a virtual machine that is sliced into how many containers you allow the system to do. So when you're configuring Cloud Foundry, you can say, I want up to 10 containers, up to 20 containers, maybe only one container if you have complete single tenant mode. And the cloud controller has a list of all the DEAs that is available, and it's locating the appropriate DEA to run the app. How does it locate it? It's on parameters like where is the next available VM that has enough memory. The way, do you remember when I defined the memory? That's where it looks for the enough memory on the container. And it will make sure that, let's say, this app has 10 instances, so it will not put all of those 10 instances in the same VM for obvious reasons. So once it's located, and another thing is the DEA pool. So if I define a DEA pool, then the cloud controller will also make sure that it's routed to the appropriate DEA pool. Now, once the app is inside the container, the case of what the example we've shown, remember those 56 megs? We take them inside the container, we unzip it, we install everything in the right order, and we run the app. And once the app is running, basically the DEA communicates with the router. The router is a component within Cloud Foundry that basically knows how to route the traffic directly from the users into the appropriate container. So it's not routing the traffic to a VM. It's routing the traffic into a container within a VM. So the router now knows that there is an app running inside this DEA VMs in a certain container, and it can route the traffic directly. It will also tell the cloud controller that this app is now available. And why is that important? Because maybe I want to scale this. So I want to say, or maybe the one of the containers died. So the cloud controller needs to know what is the desired state versus what is the real state. So for example, if two instances died, I can start two new ones. And this can happen, it happens exactly the same whether I'm targeting CF from an internet, public cloud, or intranet, or if the infrastructure itself is running on a private or public cloud. It all behaves exactly the same. So I think in terms of timing, we'll stop here, and we can come back to questions after the two other sessions. Make sense? Cool. Just 1 minute. Okay, go ahead. Oh, by the way, I forgot to actually show you the app. But if you wanna see the app, it's a pretty simple. Let's see. Here. Okay, never mind. Go ahead. So let's get back to the slides here, and we can go back to questions afterwards.
Okay. All right. Thanks, Ezekiel.
Sure.
Hello, everyone. My name is Christophe Lévesque. I'm a software engineer or architect at AppDirect, and I'm going to talk to you a bit more about the service brokerage capabilities that are now available in Cloud Foundry and that have been built in partnership with AppDirect. So I think some of you might have already attended the Cloud Foundry platform conference a couple of days ago. So for those, the next few slides might look a bit like déjà vu, but for the others, it should be hopefully like fresh new content. So just to define exactly what I'm talking, when I'm referring to services and service providers and service brokers, when a developer builds applications, often the developer is going to need to have extra services to for his application to run. So those services can be database as a service, if he needs a MySQL database or Mongo database to store and read data from, as well as email for sending email like SendGrid, or New Relic for performance monitoring and seeing how their apps are running. So this is what I'm talking when I'm referring to services and service brokerage. So before jumping in, I'm going to briefly just go over what AppDirect is, as most of you might not be familiar with us already. So AppDirect was actually founded a few years ago. It's still a fairly new company. We launched in late 2009, and we started out as trying to become the leading provider of cloud services and marketplace and management solutions. So what this means is that we started out by building white label marketplaces to distribute and sell to large telco, and build a platform where independent developers could integrate the applications, their services, and then be distributed through our network of marketplaces. And we've already powered many marketplaces around the world, Cloud Foundry being the latest one, but we've also have some other big names like Staples, Deutsche Telekom in Germany, and many others. The value proposition that we have for service developers, service providers, is that those providers can integrate to the AppDirect platform and then be distributed seamlessly to our network of marketplaces. Another interesting tidbit about AppDirect is that it was built, it relies heavily on the Spring Framework. It's a Java shop. And therefore, we are very excited to be part of Spring One and be part of the Cloud Foundry community. So just going over like the last couple of years and how what path AppDirect took to be part of Cloud Foundry now is, so we started in 2009 and we launched our first public marketplace in early 2011 with Bell Canada, which is one of the leading Canadian ISP. But then we started attracting a couple service providers, such as Wave, Accounting, and SalesPod. And over the next few years, we've won a few awards and recognition, and we've built up our catalog of applications, as well as the number of marketplaces we've powered. So to this day, we now have a very large platform with a very comprehensive set of a very comprehensive catalog of applications and service providers. That covers anything like databases, like Redis, Cloud Ability, Cloud Passage, some cloud security tools, and many others. And we've also released many marketplaces around the world. I was mentioning Deutsche Telekom and Staples, but we also power Swisscom, who is one of the Cloud Foundry partners also, Rackspace, Comcast, and others. So, How does AppDirect get to partner with Cloud Foundry? So as I was saying, we started out by being mostly a provider of web applications for enterprises. So how did we get to actually extend the functionality of Cloud Foundry to offer services which don't really have anything related necessarily to web applications? So as we built our platform and as we started integrating more and more applications, we realized that the platform that we had built initially to distribute web applications could, those techniques that we developed could be applied to any kind of online or digital services. So it became a really good fit. And when Cloud Foundry started to look for some partners to power their service catalog, AppDirect became a natural fit. And the reason why is because the reason why this partnership is great for both parties is that Cloud Foundry can really focus on building what's core to their business, which is all the Cloud Foundry source code, all the hosting, all the deployment of the application, all the management, and all those exciting features that you've seen. And at the same time, AppDirect can build, can keep on working and building a catalog of applications that's going to be really helpful and useful for developers to build their applications. Now, the question is on everybody's mind right now, hopefully, is how does this integration work? So Dekel has been showing a few of the components that make up a Cloud Foundry instance, Cloud Foundry infrastructure. So you have the cloud controller, you have Bosch at the lower part, and then you have this part, which is the service broker. So the integration between Cloud Foundry and AppDirect Marketplace is really a three-way integration. On one side, you have Cloud Foundry, which hosts all the user accounts. It hosts the user applications and so on. And on the other side of the spectrum, you have the service providers, which is going to be MongoLab, Redis, SendGrid, who are going to be providing services that developers need. And in the middle of this this picture, you have AppDirect, which acts as a hub where Cloud Foundry communicates the user commands, like the user wants a service, the user wants to buy that service to an app, and then AppDirect will then dispatch that that message to the appropriate service provider so that they can do the necessary step and fulfill the contract that they have. So the first part of the, well, the most, the one of the steps that service providers need to do to be able to be part of this overall picture is to integrate their offering, their add-ons offering, their services to the AppDirect platform. So this is done in mostly three main steps. The first step is AppDirect offers a web interface for service providers to actually enter marketing content about their services. So it's going to include a set of features, benefits, some marketing content on why should developers use their services. And they can also upload a bunch of screenshots, some images to better describe their service offering. Another step that developers will be taking is entering, obviously, the different plans that that they have. So if you take a database as a service, you can have several plans. You can start from probably with a free plan, which has a limit on the size of the database you can have. But you can also have like a paid plans that allow for more production-ready databases or services. So AppDirect has a very powerful billing engine, which is used by developers to or by service providers to describe the offering. So they will be able to configure prices in dollar per month, put caps on the number of the size of the database, for example, set up recurring fees, flat fees, and so on. And last step is, which is the most technical part of the integration for service providers, is actually in addition to now having the marketing content be on the marketplace, on the CMS of the marketplace, is to actually have a technical integration, an API integration between the AppDirect marketplace and the service provider. This is how the marketplace will communicate to the service providers about all the events that have happened on the marketplace. When somebody tries to purchase one of their service, tries to bind it to an application, this is what I'm talking about when I'm referring to the API integration. So we have several different events that this API integration covers. It goes from the subscription management, how you create a subscription, how you cancel it when you want to stop using the service. We also offer some user-level functionality on determining who can access what account. And we also have some Cloud Foundry-specific events, such as binding and unbinding, when a user wants to connect the service to the application to use them. So going a little bit into more detail about this technical integration. So I think most of you are probably now familiar with the CF command line that Dekel was referring to. When you want to get a service, you run on your command line the CF create service, and it gives you a list of services you want to get. Then you're going to select one of those services, and then it's going to send a call to Cloud Foundry, and then Cloud Foundry will then dispatch it to AppDirect, which will then talk to the ISV. So the flow of event is as described on this slide. you have the Cloud Foundry Common, which is a create service or bind service that comes to AppDirect. AppDirect then looks up which service provider is being targeted by this command, and then we'll translate this in the language that the service provider can understand. So we have various event types that we support. We have the subscription order, which is equivalent to going to a provider website and say, oh, I want to register for an account. And then once you have an account with the service provider, you can start adding services to it, adding add-ons. So you can order an add-on that gets added to your subscription. You can bind it to your app, unbind it, cancel, and then cancel the overall account. And the way it works behind the scene is that the integration is a very very simple message/listener architecture, where where the service provider registers a webhook on on the marketplace, and that listens for events from AppDirect, from the marketplace. AppDirect send then notifications to the service provider, which will then read information about the full event, knowing which service the user is targeting, what plan the user is trying to provision an account for, and eventually process the information and then return a success back to the marketplace. So that's the integration between the marketplace, the service broker, and the service providers. Now, the other side of this integration, obviously, is the part which is communicating between Cloud Foundry, the service broker in Cloud Foundry, and AppDirect as a marketplace, as a platform. So we have a couple APIs that are coming into play for this integration. We have the catalog API and the profile API, which work in tandem. The catalog API is really a listing API which Cloud Foundry uses to get the list of services that are available on the marketplace. So it's basically the way for Cloud Foundry to say, hey, like the marketplace, what are the services that can be distributed on Cloud Foundry? This is the catalog API. Now, when Cloud Foundry wants to actually get more information about the service, get all the information about the marketing content, they call the second API, which is the profile API. And those are very straightforward REST API, just a simple get to get a list and a JSON representation. Now, lastly, the most complex API, which is the one that gets used when the user actually purchase or tries to create a service for the application, is the service APIs that are exposed between Cloud Foundry and AppDirect, and those are hosted by AppDirect. So, anytime a user sends a create service, Cloud Foundry transforms that into a JSON payload and sends it to the service API. So it's a pretty straightforward REST web service. It has a JSON representation. It's really just a CRUD operation on the services. So it's a create, not really not so much update, but create, read, and delete. AppDirect then keeps track of all the services that have been created, keep track of the records of the services that have been created on the service providers, and then sends back the information to Cloud Foundry to update the user environment. And lastly, I mentioned is there's also a billing integration between Cloud Foundry and the marketplace to be able to gather all the charges that have been incurred by the user onto a single bill, so you have only a single point of billing. You don't have to go chase like 50 different bills from all your providers. Everything is managed into one location. Now I'm going to finish on this last two screenshots, which show basically the beginning and the end result of an app integration. So on the left, you have a screenshot of the CMS portal, which service provider use to enter information about the application. So they can enter information about what the name of the service is, which plans they have, what benefits they have, a bunch of screenshots. And then, thanks to the API I just mentioned earlier, Cloud Foundry will be pulling this information from the marketplace, and then we'll be able to populate the web console and provide the user a very rich experience when looking for services on the marketplace. So I'm going to stop here, and I'm going to give the floor to Scott, who's going to do a very exciting demo about that ties everything together. Thank you.
Thanks, Christophe. Can you take this one?
Hi, guys. Okay, so my name's Scott Mott, and so you've heard about the infrastructures, basically, of AppDirect and Cloud Foundry. I really love what they're doing. Basically, they're making developers' lives easier. So Cloud Foundry is making it easy for us to just push apps up there and actually have code running and be live. And AppDirect's really making it easier for people like me, and maybe you guys too, to create services, put them on a marketplace, basically like an app store, but an app store for developers, and then, you know, maybe provide nice services for people and maybe make an extra buck. And eventually that helps the developers down the road as well. So I'm with a company called SendGrid. Basically, we're an API company concerning email. We make it super simple to send and also to receive email in your application. So what does that mean? We're kind of like a turnkey solution where you can just drop in a bit of code and send email. You don't have to set up SMTP, like your own SMTP servers, keep that running, that sort of thing. You can do that infrastructure with us. So we've got an SMTP API, we've got a web API, and now what we're excited about is we've got this Cloud Foundry add-on, thanks to working with AppDirect and Cloud Foundry. So I'm going to go ahead and just before I get into code, just to give you a quick overview, but you've probably already got the gist of this basically, is that SendGrid, we're a service on Cloud Foundry that you can add on, but we're going through AppDirect and they're really doing that middle layer for us. So if you've got your own idea that you want to build and put up on Cloud Foundry, you can go through AppDirect the same, and then that would be available to developers. And Deckel talked a lot about that as well. So let's go ahead and let's do some code. All right, so I've got here on the right side, on your right, just a simple Spring app. It's just basically a sign-up app that will send you an email. So let's just get that running locally. And I'm a big fan of Gradle. So if you guys haven't tried it, I definitely recommend it. If you're a command line type person like me, it's great. So that's just going to get that app set up. So now it's localhost 8080. All right, so there's our app. Just a super simple app. I'm calling it Spring Attack. It'll send me pictures of Spring in my email. So like the Spring, yeah. So I can put that in and send that. Except I'm not going to actually get that email yet. That's an old one. Because I haven't configured my credentials through Cloud Foundry to send that. So now we're going to do that live. Let's just kill that. And I'll show you the piece of code that's going to take in the credentials. So you can see here that we're going to take in the environment variable SendGrid username, SendGrid password. And we're going to use this Java library that's open sourced with us that you just drop in. And basically you set a to address, a from address, you set your subject, some HTML, and it'll shoot you out an email. So let's actually take this just Spring app that has this little library in it, and let's put it up online and actually send an email. So we're going to do that from our command line tool. You saw Deckel show you the plugin through Eclipse, which is also awesome. I'm a fan of the command line. Their command line, I've used multiple passes. Their command line is the best I've seen. I really like their command line. So let's go ahead and we're going to come over here. We're going to set our target. So this could be your own target if you had that. And that's going to set that up. And then I'm going to go ahead and log in. And that's just going to use the credentials I signed up with on Cloud Foundry. Okay, so I'm authenticated. And then I'm just going to assemble my WAR file. So just my app that I just want to push up. Okay, so that's assembled. All right, and then I'm just going to go ahead and push the location of that WAR file. So literally, in a few commands, we're going to be able to get this up online. Okay, and it's going to ask me what I want to name it. This is where I really like this command line tool. So I'm going to call it Spring Attack. I'm going to set it to one instance. Let's go ahead and give it the 512. And subdomain Spring Attack, that sounds good to me. And we'll host it on CF Apps. And we won't do the services yet. We're going to add SendGrid just after that. But you could add it right there, just right away if you wanted to. But I want to show you the other command line for that. So that's uploading right now, and depending on the speed of the internet, that'll take a little bit of time, but it's basically pushing it up to Cloud Foundry like you saw, and Cloud Foundry is doing all the magic behind the scenes to take that WAR file, and we'll just host it for us. Okay, so there's the OpenJDK coming in, and we'll get ready with it. This is what it's going to look like. It's not live up there yet. Just a second. Once that gets up there, then we'll add SendGrid as a service, and you'll see after we do that that we'll be able to send an email out, and it'll be a live email. So there's Tomcat coming up. There's uploading the droplet. Gives you the size of the droplet, and we'll see it right after this start up the server, basically. So there we go. It's checking the status. Okay, and we've got one instance running. And you could scale this out to as many instances as you want. And that's what we do, too, at SendGrid. Like, you just hook things up, and we just handle the instances for you. Okay, so now I've got this app here, Spring Attack. I press Submit. And this is live. This is online. It says success. Check your email. But I still won't have the email there. I haven't configured that yet. So now let's go back and configure the email. Okay, so he's asking what's actually happening in terms of binding. We haven't bound the SendGrid service yet, so we're about to do that right now.
Yeah, so the application is still running. What is it that's not happening that's supposed to happen?
Oh, okay, I'll show you right now. What's not happening that's supposed to happen is we'll add the service. That will communicate to our service, SendGrid, and it'll basically set up a username and password that we then pass into our environment, and then we'll be able to send emails via that. So right now it's trying to send it, but it's basically saying your authentication's incorrect, and it's just proceeding onward.
Okay, so I mean, there are errors that are occurring, but you just not noticing that in the application.
Yeah, there's not like a hard raise error. There's just we haven't configured those credentials just for SendGrid. So, and that's by design with our system there. Was there another question? Nope. Okay. So now we'll go ahead, and this is where the magic happens basically from AppDirect, is we're going to create a service called SendGrid. And it knows, okay, there's SendGrid. It just gives us a name for that. We'll choose the free plan. That's what we have right now. Right now you get up to like 25,000 emails on the free plan. You might even get away with more than that. So go ahead and get signed up. All right, so that's on there. And then we just need to bind that to our choice app. So I've just got the one app right now. So you'll just see a list of one, my Spring Attack. But if you had multiple apps there, you could bind that service to as many apps as you need email with. So we're saving the hassle of having to set up a whole SMTP server and keep that running and have all those processes. So that'll bind. Okay. And now if we take a look at our logs. And we might have to just restart the app real quick. Yep. So there's a VCAP services variable there. Let's just restart it. If it's really soon after we just did it, then it won't show. So that's stopping. And then also the great thing about Cloud Foundry, while this is stopping and starting, it's really like still keeping you up 100% of the time because it's kind of happening behind the scenes. So another great thing about Cloud Foundry. So there's the uploading droplet, then it'll start up again.
Except for right now you're completely down, right? You go back to your site, try to send yourself mail.
The site would technically not be completely down right now, right? So it would just be,
yeah, well,
yes.
The way to do it is you'll start a new instance and you remap the URL, and the remapping will take you like 2 milliseconds. So essentially if you want to have a complete no downtime, you would start a second instance and remap the URL. Here, in that case of an update, it will have a downtime while it's remapping, so it will have a little downtime. If you want to have zero downtime, you just start a separate instance and then remap the URL.
Okay, so there you go. So there, now in our VCAP services, we can see our SendGrid services in there and any other services you'd add, so New Relic, MongoDB, the MySQL, it all gets dropped into that one environment variable, which is really great. So I could just pull those out automatically there, but I also want to show you that you can also set local environment variables. So I'm going to go ahead and copy and paste these and just show you that from the command line as well. Let me just come down here. And the command for that is basically cf set environment variable, the name of your app, what you want for your environment variable, and then the value of that. So I'm going to set my username. That's going to set that right now, and then I'm going to go to the password next. Let's go ahead and copy and paste that. Okay. So now we're put our username and password in there from that add-on that we have, our SendGrid add-on. And now if we go back to our app, once that's up, so there's our instance running. That environment variable is getting passed right here, username and password. And if we come here, let's go back. Just refresh that, there we go. Now if I put this in, this is basically going through Cloud Foundry, through to us at SendGrid. And now if we take a look at the email, see if it came to this one. There it is. So it's arrived. Thanks for signing up. Put in the picture. You can add attachments, everything like that. So that quickly, you put up an app. You have email. You get all kinds of metrics as well with SendGrid, which is really great. And so that's kind of the basics of it. So just a quick review. The app is up online if you want an example. github.com/scottmott/springattack. So you can actually see the example code. That's some of the code we wrote. We've threw it up on Cloud Foundry's awesome cloud. AppDirect basically did the magic right there of adding the service. So if you build your own services, you can do that too. Like maybe you build a text messaging system or something and you want that on Cloud Foundry. That we threw it up and we got an email. Basically, at SendGrid, we really like to solve problems for developers. That's why it's been so great working with these guys, because they're trying to do the same thing. So we've been partners with them. We're stoked to be up there. I definitely recommend trying to get on Cloud Foundry, build your own tools, and use those services if you need them as well. Question?
Yeah. I'm checking more into the global life cycle. So okay. If I understood correctly, the app actually Cloud Foundry takes care to restart the apps if some instances fail or something like this, but the services are kind of remote, so the application cannot make any assumption about what's going with those services. And let's say that for whatever reason service goes out, is some provisioning within the Cloud Foundry to, I'm not sure, pool of connections or take care of something similar like the application, or it's up to the application to provision itself and to recover situations like
so the health manager essentially takes care of the app instances. So if that goes down, it restarts the app instances. On the services side, so you will have to, you can get notification that a service is down, and you can, services that are managed via the service broker, right? Not defined services. You can basically make a call to say, restart my service, or, but it's up to the app, or up to the user, not to the app, up to the user to basically restart the service in case it's down.
And
so we are basically we will allow you to manage a life cycle, but you will need to make the call to start the service.
And
to restart the service.
And first,
within your application itself, or
you can do both. You can you see everything that is the command line is basically a REST API.
Yeah.
So essentially, you can do the same thing directly.
So
from
you can actually intercept recent for notifications at that level and restart the service.
Yes. You can do that. But the other thing.
For a service like ours, once it's started up, there's nothing else you need to do. So we handle your mail coming in and queuing it. And
let's just assume that something happens bad and your service gets away.
Okay.
I think you're asking more like if it's a MySQL kind of service that you need. But I think in the case of SendGrid, they take care of the service lifecycle.
I'm trying to think about the global SLA. So your application itself.
Each service provider will have its own SLA. So SendGrid, if something goes down, they are like on it right away.
But the protocol for this is not part of the communication.
It's individual by each service provider. So once the service is provisioned, there is a direct relationship between the app and the service itself.
At application level.
Application.
Go ahead. So, did we have any documentation on the recommended hardware configuration for installation of Cloud Foundry?
Yes, absolutely. It's all in docs.cloudfoundry.com/run, and I can share it with you. So you have exactly what is the minimum configuration for running Bosch on a lab environment, on a production environment, what's the, all of that is online.
Okay.
There is just, you know, nothing that we're doing, there is no kind of hidden documentation that comes with a product kind of thing. Everything in Cloud Foundry is online, docs.cloudfoundry.com.
You mentioned that the applications are deployed as wars. How are those wars generated? Are you using the Eclipse normal project metadata to generate the war, or can I use some?
Whatever you like, we're not generating the war. I mean, the input to Cloud Foundry is a war file. You can generate it in whatever way you like, Maven, Gradle.
It's Gradle.
But your the Eclipse plugin. I didn't see where I picked a war. You just tell it to deploy on Cloud Foundry. So how does it know to get the war?
When I dragged and dropped the project, basically, since it's a Maven project, there was a Maven build behind it.
So the Maven build is what?
But this is just an example. I can do exactly the same by dragging. I actually have a Gradle project there as well. And I can do the same drag and drop, and it will use the Eclipse dot whatever. Extension, EWR or something.
Okay.
Well, this, I showed you an example from STS. When you're going to a command line, when you're doing CF push, you can, that's a Ruby project, then you would basically point to the folder where your .rb file is, and you have a manifest file that has all your gems, like a Ruby gem file, and we'll basically identify that this is a Ruby app, and we'll start a specific build pack for Ruby that essentially, instead of bringing Tomcat and Apache, it will kind of download the gems and the thing server and so on.
And the build pack documentation will have the deployment characteristics and all that.
There is a default build pack for Ruby, and it's similar to Java. You can customize this to use. In the case of Ruby, there is little need to customize it because it's essentially just saying, here is my thing server, and here is the list of gems that are based on your gem file. So, and in Node.js, again, simple. A different way to kind of download your .js files directly from the folder. The difference between the Node and the Node Ruby and the Java example is we are also have a compilation step as part of that build pack, which we don't have for Java. Right? So in the case of deploying a Ruby app, we're actually also we're starting from a plain source file. In Java, we're starting from a compiled code. This is just a decision based on like how Java developers like to interact with the system versus Ruby.
In the bookstore example that you showed, you said that whether we are connecting to an available service, binding to an available service, or a user-defined provision service, it doesn't make a difference.
Correct.
Right? I'm just thinking, like, if I bind to an available RDBMS service, it gives me a blank database, so I might have to create the tables and store the data. But if I connect to a user-defined service, my DBM might have already created all the tables to schema. So how do I differentiate?
So in the example I've shown, we actually created the tables within MySQL based on a persistency.xml file. That's just an example for that makes it easier for Spring guys. I mean, you can decide to create the schema on your own, or you can have someone create the schema for you. We essentially don't, it's totally up to the application. So in that example, it's not related to a user-defined versus a core service. In both cases, even if it's a core service, I can start from a blank database and not have any schema and basically go directly to the database and create the tables if I want, or I can import a schema like I did in books. It's totally up to you. It's not, Cloud Foundry is not playing a role in creating those schemas. It basically execute whatever the application is designed to do.
Therefore, that my logic goes into the application, right? Suppose if I'm connecting to a user-defined service, I must assume that it's already provisioned.
Correct, but it's the same thing for connecting to a core service. You should see, I mean, if your application just, my application basically had the table schema in it.
So it generated the table schema, but it will do exactly the same with my Oracle if I had permissions to do it, right? So it's not.
If you're using service provider database, if you get MongoDB database from MongoDB, for example, you can also single sign up from your Cloud Foundry account into the MongoLab portal, where you can actually see your database and connect to it through another way. You don't have to go through the application to connect to the database. You can also go through the provider portal.
So
if you want to create some of the tables before, if you want to start selling data, you can do that without going through the application.
So you're saying there's a backdoor, I can do a VPN to the actual service? And
it's called tunneling, so you can do CF tunnel and you can go directly to the service and create the tables if you want. The example I've shown is that it's all done in the application code using the Spring persistency object, hybrid and stuff, but it's just an example, right? So you can...
Thank you.
So the warden is essentially part of a DA is a VM that is in Cloud Foundry every VM essentially gets a role, a stencil, right? So a VM can be a DA, a VM can be a service node, a VM can be a service broker, or a VM can be a health manager or one of the other core Cloud Foundry components. In the case of the VM is a DA, what happens is Cloud Controller knows that he has a registry of all the VMs that are classified as DAs. And once it's